There's something happening in everyone's hearts here. Everyone's hearts. Even if you're trying not to cooperate, even in your heart, God is doing something. Believe me. I'm going to say that again. Even if you're trying not to cooperate, the Holy Spirit is actually still at work in you. He's going after it. You are being confronted. He got you here today. He's winning. Amen. He's winning. Amen. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Shukala borasodavice. Let's go to Mark chapter 4 and find me that place where it says, yeah, do it in King James. Start with verse 1. Mark chapter 4. Listen, I want you all to just make sure you sit still and listen to this word. Don't get distracted. Don't have to move around. Get this word. Get this word. Okay? Hallelujah. And he began to teach by the seaside, and there were gathered unto him a great multitude. So he entered into a ship and sat in the sea, and the whole multitude was by the sea on the land. Keep going. And he taught them many things by parables, and said unto them in his doctrine. Doctrine means teaching. Hearken, behold. Now that's a command. And so I'm saying to you today, hearken, behold. What does hearken mean? Look at the first four letters of that word. Hear. Okay? Behold. So, listen and look. Hearken, behold. Listen and look. Okay? What he wants you to look at is not a guy sitting in a boat, because that's what he was doing. That's not what he's trying to get you to see. He's trying to get you to see what he's about to say. He wants you to use your imagination. He wants you to see what he's about to say. So he's saying, hearken, behold, listen. Now look at this. Listen. Now look at this. There went out a sower to sow. Okay, get the picture? Everybody got the picture in the mind? Okay, you got a sower. You know, he's got probably a satchel on his side, right? And he's got seed in that satchel, and he's going out to sow some seed. And it came to pass as he sowed, some fell on the wayside, and the fowls, or the birds of the air, came and devoured it up. They ate up all that seed. That's what happens in the parking lot sometimes. After you walk out of church and you get a distraction, or you get in a fight, or you get in a wreck, you get in this or that. Okay, no wrecks, in Jesus' name. No fights in the parking. Let's just bless the parking lot, right? But the devil comes immediately to try to steal the word that was sown in your heart. The birds come to eat the seed. We got to stop them. And you have the power to stop them. Because I'll tell you this, birds can't eat seed that is a half an inch or an inch under the soil. It can't. Birds can't eat the seed that's under the soil. It's only the seed that's on top of the soil. You know what the seed on top of the soil is? It's the word you hear but don't understand. When you hear scriptures spoken, you hear the pastor preaching, and you just don't get it. So you're like, I don't know what that was all about. I don't understand. What did that mean? Hearken, behold, thus and though and thou and holy and righteous. And those words don't mean anything to me. Get understanding. When you get understanding that seed gets pushed down into the soil. And the birds of the air cannot eat it up. You get it? Those birds are demons. They're just coming to snatch up the word and eat it and fly away. They don't care about you, really. And besides, you know, if you were to talk to one of them, they're like, listen, it's nothing personal. It's just business. They're just there. That's their job. They come and eat seed. If you got word in your mind you don't understand, it's the devil's job to try to steal it. Nothing personal. It's just business. He wants it done. All right? His master said, go get that. Go get that seed that's laying there. It's not even in the soil. They don't even understand what they just heard. Understanding the word pushes that seed down into the soil. Understand this? Tell my kids, tu comprends? And some fell on stony ground where it had not much earth. That means it had a little bit of earth. And immediately it sprang up because it had no depth of earth. So the seed instantly started growing and it popped up. Why? It's looking for more life. When it's trying to go against that rock, there's no life in that rock. So it pushes up to where it can find life. That's why it jumps up so quickly. When it's stony ground like that, the plant will jump up quickly because it's looking for more life. Cody, grab, there's a bottle of water behind the sub if you could grab it. I set it on there and it vibrated right off. But when the sun came up, it was scorched, and because it had no root, it withered away. So the seed that was sown on stony ground, that's where your heart is hard. And even though you receive it and you understand it, there's something in your heart that's blocking you from actually letting that word grow in you. Your heart itself is blocking you from allowing the word of God to flourish in your life. Well, what can make a stony heart? Oh, I guess you're all the experts on that one. We're all experts on that. What can make a stony heart? Offense. Unforgiveness. Right? We gotta get rid of this stuff. Our hearts are so precious, so precious. I told you the story last week or the week before, whenever it was, about how Nancy was believing God for a house with 5 raised irrigated gardens, right? And we just so happened to get this house, and it was crazy how it happened. I'm getting a little warm up here. So can I? So we got this house, and it had 5 raised irrigated gardens in the backyard. I told you we planted lettuce. We had no idea how much lettuce to plant. We probably should have planted a square foot of it. We planted about 10 square feet or 20 square feet, and we didn't know what to do with all that lettuce then, and because it sprang up quick. But then the weeds came. Man, we didn't realize anything about weeds. And you got to protect your heart. Your heart is a garden. Your heart is a garden. Your heart is a garden. And your heart is where the word of God must be planted. When the word of God is planted in your heart and you understand it, that's when you'll begin to see fruit. That's when you'll begin to see things changed. However, if you're carrying rocks around in your heart and you got a stone cold heart, or just a few pebbles, or just a big rock, or just a rock or two, you know, whatever you got in there, it's stopping the word of God from growing. If you want to see a harvest in your life, if you want to see a harvest in your life, decide what you're going to plant. Thanks so much. Decide what you're going to plant in your heart. Decide what kind of harvest do you want. You are a farmer. Sorry, I know most of you live in the city. You are a farmer. Whether you like it or not, Nancy and I, once we planted those seeds in that garden, we were gardeners. But we didn't know anything about being a gardener, except planting the seed. Go take some when it's grown. We didn't know anything else. You are a gardener. You are a farmer. You have a field. It is your heart. And your heart needs to be protected. Okay? Let me go a little farther on this. Some fell among the thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no fruit. The thorns, Let's go back to the thorns. It fell among the thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no fruit. What are the thorns? What are the weeds? What are the weeds in our heart? Lies, offenses, what else? The cares of this world, right? Bad company. Deceit. Say it again. Negativity. Distractions. Right? Anything that's getting you away from farming your heart is a distraction. Gardening your heart, protecting your heart, right? Weeds do. I know the Word of God is powerful, but I'm telling you, weeds have the power to overcome it. Because it's all based on your will. Because we choose every weed. Ouch. You choose every weed. Just saying. But you don't know what he did to me. Yeah, you just chose to be offended. But he did that to me. And then you chose to be offended. But he did it on purpose. And then you chose to be offended. But it's not right what they did. It's not right. And then you chose to be offended. But I have a right. Maybe I don't. But I have a right to be angry. Okay. So, you want to go down that lane? You have a right to be angry? You want to go there? He did this and this and this and this, and she did that and that. Well, let's get out your list. Let's get out the list of all the things you've done wrong. Let's start talking about it. Are you ready to go down that road? And every single thing you've ever done, now it's in play. Anybody want to go there? I prefer the precious blood of Jesus that made me white as snow. And I think I'm going to stay there instead. And I'm going to let the blood of Jesus protect me. And I'm going to let the blood of Jesus wash out my record. And he says, you got to let it do it for everybody else too. If you're going to accept that blood to wash your record, you need to let it wash everybody else's too. Now, does anybody here have a right to be offended? Anybody? Not if you're dead. Dead men don't get offended. Right? Dead men don't get offended. That's true. They don't. Because they're dead. They don't get offended. If you are dead, you won't get offended. You see this? You choose your stones. You choose your weeds for your heart. You give agreement. The devil's not strong enough. You're the one that gives agreement to all the weeds in your heart. But I didn't know that what he was telling me was wrong. Doesn't matter. You still agreed to believe it, even though you didn't know. You agreed to believe it. And now because you agreed to believe it, it's a rock in your heart, or it's a weed in your heart. And it's stopping your harvest of the Word of God from growing. We need truth. We need truth. We need the Word of God to cleanse us and purify us. We need truth. Whew. Hallelujah. Some fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no fruit. Go ahead. Next verse. And other fell on good ground. Oh, wait, there is actually a possibility of this working out okay. I forgot about that part. And other fell on good ground, and it did yield fruit that sprang up and increased and brought forth some 30 and some 60 and some 100. Wait a second. I want to be that guy. I want to be that guy. I just I just plead the blood of Jesus over you. I just speak, just like I did for the kids. Father God, I just speak your protection over every person here and over their hearts, that you would teach them. First of all, you would protect them, but then you would teach them how to protect their own heart so that the harvest they get would be the harvest they want. In the name of Jesus, some fell on good ground. You ever see some people and you just wonder, how in the world are they growing so fast? How is it that everybody's hearing the same word and this person's going, woo, what is up with that? I found out years ago, they asked, back before I became a staff member back at Praise Fellowship, I heard them get up at the pulpit and say, you know, we have a member here who just seems, and we were talking at the staff meeting, how is it that this one person just seems to be growing and growing so rapidly? Well, that's what happens. I found out that was actually me that they were talking about. How is it? You know, when I was a little boy, there were some things going on in my house that ought not to be going on in a house. But guess what happened to me? I got a dust allergy. You know what happened when I got a dust allergy? The doctor said he needs to keep his window open year-round. So my parents bought me an electric blanket and gave me my own bedroom. Now, having your own bedroom when you got 14 kids in the family, that's living. That's living. But you know what happened to me? Nothing. You know what happened to other kids in the family? Something. You know what happened to me? Nothing. I even got accused my brother. He said, Joseph, it just seems like you live in a bubble. Hallelujah. Thank God. Thank God I live in a bubble. And while I was about 45, I said, Lord, why did you do that? And he said, son, I wanted your heart to be absolutely supple, pure, and responsive. I didn't want it to be just full of all kinds of offenses and all kinds of experiences that would warp you. He said, because I wanted you to be able to bring healing to my people. I was working with one lady and she said, well, why you and why not me? You know what? All I know is it was like an ark. I was protected from the flood. You know, it wasn't for my sake that God did that. It was for yours. Amen. It was for your sake. It wasn't for my sake. I came so close to death so many times. I had so many things wrong with me. But God's protection just kept, he kept protecting me. He kept going. I just had unusual favor on my life. Unusual favor. I got baptized with the Holy Spirit. Things started happening. I got baptized in the Spirit when I was in eighth grade. When I was a freshman coming into the new high school, right? I'm sitting there just playing my piano, you know, playing some songs that the, you know, people would know. I just start playing the piano and so I start singing songs. The senior football players would come hang around me. I got asked out. When I was a freshman, I got asked out by a senior girl. That's crazy favor. I'm just telling you. That's crazy favor. Okay? I'm telling you. All right. Close your ears. I mean, these girls came to me, wanted to make out with me, and I would laugh. I thought they were joking. I thought it was so funny. And I would just laugh and laugh. I was naive as you could get. Hallelujah. Oh, I was so blessed. I'm talking about a bubble. Talking about my heart being guarded, protected. It was so funny. And I didn't realize till long time later that they were serious. And I thought, oh, praise the Lord, I'm glad I missed that. So glad. I am not kidding you. I'm not kidding you. That's the favor of God and the protection of God. Why? Because he wants to guard our hearts. And the most important thing is that you have a pure heart. I would venture to say that for many of you, the reason that this is your church is because you sense there's a pure heart here. I am not on the take. I'm assigned here by my Father, whom I love dearly, and I want to see him smile. That's why I'm here. I want to obey him, and I'm not willing to disobey him. I'm going to stand here, and I'm going to speak the word of God, and I'm going to let his words come through me to minister and to bless. In the name of Jesus, that's what I'm going to do. All right, let me go to a few scriptures, but let's first jump over. Well, you ready, Ole? Let's get rolling here. 1 John 4:6. 1 John 4:6. I got to get some more of this word into you. This is good so far, and for many, that would be a sufficient meal, but God's got more on the table. You need to know. 1 John 4:6. 1 John 4:6. You're doing all right, darling. I appreciate you. We are of God. He that knoweth God hears us. But he that is not of God hears not us. Hereby we know we the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. We are of God. Now, John the Apostle is talking here. John the Apostle is the one that leaned back on Jesus' chest during the Last Supper. He knew Jesus personally. He knew that God had exalted Jesus to his right hand. Okay? He's saying, listen, I know the truth. He would be lying if he said he didn't know the truth. And he said, we are of God. He said, listen, I was sent here by God. And he said, we are of God. He that knows God hears us. He that is not of God does not hear us. This is how we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. Thank you for listening today. Thank you for listening. Because the spirit of truth is at work to minister the word of God to your heart. And I have not even an ounce of boastfulness in my heart about that. It's the truth. What you're hearing is the truth. John 14:17. I'm going to just read, Oli, and you just catch up, okay? Even the spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it sees him not, neither knows him. But ye know him, for he dwells with you, and he shall be in you. How many of you have been baptized with the Holy Spirit? Raise your hand. You've been baptized with the Holy Spirit? Awesome, 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 awesome. The Holy Spirit lives in you. Amen? The Spirit of truth dwells in you. That means the Spirit in you is tending towards righteousness. He's tending towards the truth. He has a natural pull towards the truth. Okay? So, John 14:6. Jesus saith unto him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. Jesus himself is the way. Jesus himself is the truth. Okay? You hang out with Jesus, and lies start to disappear. So, you know, if you got lies in your heart, and you wonder, how am I going to get these lies out of my heart? You don't know which ones are lies. But as you start to hang out with Jesus, it becomes real clear which ones are lies. Because he is the way. He's the truth, and he is the life. Are we good? All right. John 17, verse 17. Jesus was praying for his disciples and for all of us, okay? And Jesus said, sanctify them through thy truth. Jesus said, thy word is truth. Do you know that truth will sanctify you? You know what sanctify means? It means pluck the weeds out of your garden. Amen. That's what sanctify means. Get the rocks out of your heart. That's what sanctify means. Sanctify doesn't mean, oh, I'm not going to drink, I'm not going to do this, I'm not going to do all this, and then I'll be sanctified. No, 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 no. You get the rocks out of your heart and you get the weeds out of your heart. That's sanctification. You get your heart to the place where it is responsive to the word of God. You get your heart to the place where it is responsive and full of faith. That is sanctification. You get that? Because all of that other fruit of sanctification that all the world or most of the Christians think, you know, that's sanctified. I mean, you go to some churches, man, you know, every woman's got her hair in a bun or a beehive hair or something like that. And they got no, you know, short fingernails and no makeup on. And they're, you know, they think that's sanctification. That's not sanctification. Those are outward acts. And but you know the fruit. You know them by their fruit. Okay? Do you want to grow? Do you want the word of God to grow in you to the place where you're actually experiencing life? Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. If you never spend any time in the word, that's as dumb as me and Nancy not plucking the weeds out of our garden. Because you can all sit back and laugh and say, yeah, you stupid people didn't know how to do a garden. You know, you just sit back and laugh, ha, 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 and you're not plucking the weeds out of your heart. And the devil sits back and laughs at you in turn. We can't play that game. Are we okay? I'm not mad at y'all. You know I'm not mad? Okay? I love y'all. I really do. I'm 100% honest. I love you. Okay? I'm happy you're here today. I want the word of God to penetrate your heart, and I want it to bear fruit. Amen. It's not just about seed time. It's about harvest. It's about harvest. It's about harvest. It's about harvest. The word of God is what will change you. But Pastor, I just don't get anything out of the word. You need to spend more time with it. You need to invite the Holy Spirit to teach you. You might need to go to Bible school. Dear God, man, I really believe this. There's some of you here that really need to consider going to Bible school. I especially like Andrew Womack's Bible College. It is powerful. Amen. It's life-changing. Yes, Cindy's been there. How many here have at least gone to 1 year of Karis Bible College? I'm telling you something. It is so powerful. It is. You know why it's so powerful? Because your heart gets cleaned out. Because thy truth, thy word is truth, and the truth sanctifies. So you don't really realize it, but as you're sitting listening to the word, your heart's being sanctified because lies are being removed and truth is being planted. It's such a beautiful, beautiful thing. I really believe that the Bible school's Karis is actually doing what the church is supposed to be doing. I really believe that's the church's job. And if the church had been doing their job, that Andrew would be out of business. You know, we'd just be hiring him to teach in our churches to do, you know. How we doing? Proverbs 4:23. Great are you, Lord. Proverbs 4:23. keep thy heart, or guard your heart, with all diligence. For out of it, out of what? Out of your heart, are the issues of life. Are the issues of life. Out of your heart are the issues of life. Guard your heart with all diligence, for out of your heart come the issues of life. You ever heard somebody say, she has got issues? That girl's got some issues. You know? Oh, you like that, Josh? Thanks, bud. Dame. My number one fan right there. Love him. Mr. Cute right there. Keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. I'll talk now. You can talk later, okay, bud? Keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. If you got something going on in your life and it's persistent, it keeps happening, it's over and over and over and over and over, guess what? It's coming out of your heart. You got a problem in your life and it keeps happening over and 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 over, guess what? It's coming out of your heart. You got a weed you got to pull. You got a lie you've got to dislodge. You might have a rock you need to have moved. Get a rock out of your heart. It might be so big you need a cat. What do you call those things? A caterpillar? Bobcat. Little bobcat. You might have a rock that's so big you need to get a bobcat, come in there and pick that thing up and move it. You know what that is? That's what Nathan Blouse and my daughter Natalie do. That's when you get to the point where you just really, you are stuck, and I've been there. I'm like, I've got to have somebody with a serious anointing help me get this thing. Because, and it, you know what's really, and I'm not saying there's anything that's too strong for the Word of God, because the Word of God can make all the changes you need. But if you're not getting in the Word of God enough, or if you're not paying attention to the right scriptures, or you're not allowing the Holy Spirit to speak to you on a certain area, you're going to have a big old rock that you can't get out of your heart. You go in there and pray with Natalie, and all of a sudden she starts asking you questions. The Holy Spirit starts telling you things, and you're like, oh, wow, I could be free of this. I could actually live without this rock or without this big weed that's eaten up all of my resources and eating up my life. Oh, boy. Keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Do you know that word issues right there? If you look it up in the Strong's Concordance, it also means boundaries. Boundaries. Oh. Boundaries. Out of your heart come the boundaries of your life. Out of your heart come the boundaries of your life. You may have a boundary that says, I can't go to Bible school, or I'm not going to go to Bible school. Well, what's that wall right there? What's that boundary that says you can't go to Bible school? I don't have enough money. Okay? Well, if you just take the steps, the Lord will provide. If the money's already waiting there for you, just go and God will provide. Do you believe that? I don't know if I believe it or not. Okay, well, then you got a doubt problem. Okay, so where's the doubt coming from? Okay, what are you believing? Out of your heart flow the boundaries of your life. Okay, you know, one guy was like, oh, I want to be a doctor, but being a doctor takes 10 years. Of going to school. And well, I can't spend 10 years. Well, what else are you going to do? Guess what? 10 years from now, you're going to be 10 years older. So 10 years from now, you could be a doctor or not be a doctor. But you're still going to be 10 years older 10 years from now. But if you have a boundary in your heart that says, no, I cannot, I'm not willing. Okay, well, all the people that were going to get healed from you may die. You got to watch it. If God puts something in your heart, he's putting it there for a reason. As a matter of fact, according to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, he's got appointments for you waiting, which means if you're supposed to be a doctor, he's got patients waiting for you. If you're supposed to be a real estate agent, he's got customers waiting for you. You better go get your license. I don't know what it is, what you're supposed to do. Whatever it is, find out what that boundary is in your heart and move it. So come up to the end of, I'm not even sure what year this was. It would be great if I knew what year this was. Maybe 2012. I was sitting there. It was in December, and I was waiting for, I went over to, what's our restaurant over in Yorktown? Brio. So I was sitting in Brio, this nice, what do you call it, Tuscan grill. And I was meeting an old college friend from way back, okay, one of my best friends. And he was in my wedding. He and I hadn't been together for years. And so I was sitting down in the restaurant waiting. He was supposed to be there at 6 o'clock. And he called me and said, hey, I'm going to be a little late, 45 minutes, maybe an hour late. So I asked the waitress, I said, could you give me like some paper? You know, some paper and a pen? So she did. And I sat there and wrote on the back of this tore up menu. And I said, Lord, I am not satisfied. I'm not satisfied with the boundaries of my life. I don't like where the boundaries are. I'm not happy. I said, Lord, the church is the same size as when we started. I said, my music is still not out covering the earth like you said it should be. I'm not happy with this. I'm not happy with that. And I just started listing the things. I said, Lord, I'm not happy with this. So I said, Lord, in this new year, now this is one of those prayers that don't pray this unless you're, I mean, this is one of those prayers that God delights to answer, but it's very painful in his reply. I said, Lord, my number one priority in this new year is that you help me move the boundaries of my heart. I want this fixed. If this is the source of all my problems, guess what? You think your spouse is the source of all your problems? Sorry. It's just, you're fooled. Okay? You're actually the problem. You think somebody else is your problem? You've already been deceived. It's you. It's you. It's you. It's your heart. Because the boundaries of your life are coming out of your heart. I hope you all didn't mind I took the gloves off today. We're just going at it. Is that all right? Okay. Guard thy heart with all diligence, for out of it flow the boundaries of your life. You're as wealthy as your heart can handle right now. Oh, we're believing God for this, and I'm believing God for, you know what? I'm not quite sure your heart's ready for that. There's so much I could teach on this, because your heart will self-correct. Your heart has like what, you know, like an autopilot. You say, okay, I'm going to go for, let's say you make $100,000 a year. Me? Could you? Could you ever? You could believe for that. Okay. I was driving with Josiah the other day. I said, Josiah, what if I gave you a dollar? What would you do with it? And he, I don't even know. Okay, what if I gave you $10? So all of a sudden he's thinking, let's put another zero on there. What if I gave you $100? Check this out. Please check this out. Don't fall asleep on me. I said, Josiah, what if I gave you $1,000? All of a sudden he's like, well, that's a different question. You know, because now I've got to really start thinking. All right, now wait a second, Josiah. I said, let's put another zero on there. What if I gave you $10,000? What would you do with it? Tell me. So we talked about it. And then I said, okay, let's go. What if I gave you $100,000? He said, well, I would do this and do this and this. I said, great. I said, okay, let's go farther. What if I gave you $1,000,000? Let me tell you something. These questions will challenge you to the core. These questions will uncover who you are and what your capacities are. I had a bunch of telemarketers back at Christianity Today. I used to ask them, what would you do with $1,000,000? I said, if you don't know the answer to that question, you probably will never have to answer it. If you don't know, see, you are as wealthy as your heart can handle right now. And you're believing for more, you need to believe for your heart to get fixed so you can have the capacity to receive more. You got as many relationships in your life right now as your heart can handle. Oh, Pastor, please don't go there. Please don't go there. You're as lonely right now as you are because of your heart. Oh, I'm sorry if that hurts. I love you, and I'm not mad at you. But you're as lonely as you are right now because of your heart. And if you get the weeds out of your heart, you get the yucky out of your heart, you get unforgiveness out, you get the garbage out of your heart, the boundaries of your heart will begin to expand. And your life can take on more and more and more. But I will tell you now that all of the limitations in your life are in you. Now that we can fix. That we can fix because God is over everything. We're getting ready to buy a house. And I was sitting down with the loan guy, getting ready to sign all these papers. And I mean, it's a thick stack of papers, you know. And the Lord said, don't worry about it. I own the banks. I was like, oh, okay. Beautiful. I can do this. So I just got in there, got my ugly signature going, you know, that one that nobody can read. You know, my signature's so bad. You know, when I was running the school of ministry back under Pastor Winston, and I took a digital picture of my signature, and they were printing off the diplomas with my signature, you know, because so I didn't have to sign all those signatures. Well, my son, Andrew, and this other lady were running them off, and the digital picture of my signature got flipped, and they didn't know. I thought that, no, that's good. It's really a bad, anyway, let's go back. The boundaries of your heart, the boundaries of your life are walking around inside of you every day. This is what God said to Abraham. He said, go out and look. And he said, as far as you can see, I'll give it to you. As far as you can see, I'll give it to you. I'm telling you, there's people in here that are going to get something changed today. Something's getting fixed because you're realizing, wait a second, it ain't anybody else. It's actually me. And I got to start doing some farming. I got to start forgiving. I need to get the lies out of my heart. Listen, everybody look up here. You see this? Joe started selling this a couple weeks ago. It's available back at the resource wall. It's called Identity Restoration. All it is just personal confessions, just saying who I am in Christ. So you listen in first person. This is weed killer, my friends. This is weed killer. I recommend you get this. This is power. There's power in this. Get into... Oh, I have a personal prophecy for everybody. Ready? Here's a personal prophecy from God just for you. Everybody ready? This is just for you. Just for you. Ready? This is a personal prophecy just for you. Get into the Word. Amen. Open your Bible. Get into the Scriptures. Listen to the Word. Oh, the kids bought us an Echo Dot from Amazon, and I just say, I'll be sitting on the couch. I say, Alexa, open the Bible app and read to me John 14, John chapter 14. And all of a sudden, I hear the word of God. I say, the other day I said, Alexa, open the Bible app and read the book of Deuteronomy. I just lay there and just hear this word. What am I doing? Weed killer. I'm letting the word wash me. His word is truth. His word sanctifies me. Subject yourself to the fertilizer. Subject yourself to the weed killer of the word of God. Amen. Let this stuff work, because the harvest you desire, all the answers to all your prayers are on the other side of this. All right, I have one more thing before we stop here. I saw myself doing this morning. I'm believing God for some more money for this church. And I don't have all the numbers in order as far as how much I need and what I want. But I'm telling you, and I need you. Let me put it the way I heard it, or get it accurate. This church needs more money to do the things that we're called to do eventually. Because on the growth path that we are on since January 1 of this year, and hallelujah, we're on a growth path that is beyond a rapidly growing church. A rapidly growing church, they have between, or a church that's stagnant, 3% of the visitors decide to stay. If you get to 6 to 10% of your visitors staying, you are a rapidly growing church. And the last time we checked the numbers, we were at 14%. We are beyond a rapidly growing church right now. Well, somebody better get some vision, because this room is going to hopefully pretty soon not be big enough, right? But we're going to need some money, okay? We've been doing things, and we've been, I'll just tell you the truth, we've been scraping, okay? But guess what? Where's Olivia? Olivia's back in the back. She told me a joke. She said, Daddy, listen to this joke. She always loves to read me from joke books. And this pastor says, gets up in front of the church. And the pastor says, the good news is we have all of the money we need for the building project. And the bad news, it's all still in your pockets. But that's not what I'm just telling you a joke there. Listen, I want to say something serious. And it has to do with this, the boundaries of your heart. Okay? I believe there's a lot more money supposed to flow through this church, because there's a lot of things we're supposed to be doing. Amen. There's a lot more people we're supposed to be given to. A lot, we're supposed to be stronger than what we are financially. Some of that has to do with the boundaries of my heart. I can guarantee you that because of my heart, we're just now starting to see this rapid growth. I started getting discouraged. My heart, I started losing protection over my heart. I started getting discouraged about the church and wondering what is supposed to happen. And so I started thinking, well, you know, when I go out, you know, on my missions trips, man, it's like all the provision's there and, you know, all the fruit is happening. It's awesome, awesome, awesome. Well, maybe I'm just supposed to do that. And in December, one morning, I'm sitting down, reading my Bible, writing in my journal, and I had a good time. I had a good time with the Lord. It was probably 4:30 in the morning, and I wanted to get up and go back to bed. Okay? You don't have to stay up all the time, you know? I was about ready to go back to bed, and I just thought, I'm going to linger just another moment. And when I lingered just another moment, God moved a boundary in my heart. You know what he said? He said, son, my assignment for you has not changed. He said, when it does, I will let you know. Because I was getting tired. We were doing the Keep Your Love On series. I preached the first message in that, and I just felt exhausted. I felt exhausted. I called up Natalie and Danny. I said, you guys take the rest of it. I am too tired. I said, give me some time off. I kept coming to church, but I just was tired. And in that state, the Lord spoke to me and he said, son, get back up in that pulpit and preach with all wisdom and all the vigor you got. He said, because these people need it. And he said, my assignment for you has not changed. My friends, I got to tell you, the reason we are experiencing the growth we're seeing is because God moved the boundary of my heart. I used to pastor, listen to me, did I tell you I was going to be honest? Okay. I used to pastor with one foot pointed toward the door. Does everybody know what that means? One foot pointed toward the door, like, okay, when's this going to be over? You know, right now, my feet ain't pointing toward any door. This thing is going. And I'm excited about it. I really am excited about it. My heart's in it. I'm very excited, if you hadn't noticed. But I'm telling you, the boundaries of your heart is essential, because you can fix that. You can forgive people. You can subject yourself to the truths of the Word of God, and it will change what you think. Amen. Are we doing all right?
Yeah.
You know I love you? Yeah. All right? Listen, Father God, we just thank you for this word. And we just say, birds, stay away. Okay, the Lord just corrected me. The word that you understand is the word that can't be stolen by the birds. Did you understand what I said today? All right, then take one moment and tell me, what did you get out of this message today? Go ahead, Connie.
Get into the Bible so that you can let God expand your boundaries.
Yes.
The boundaries of your heart, so that you can deal with the issues and responsibilities of your heart successfully his way daily.
Beautifully. Beautiful. What'd you get?
Just get in the Word.
Get in the Word. Danny.
With birds eating seed that you don't understand, I was just hearing that you don't protect what you don't value.
Yes.
So if you don't think there's any value to the seed that you've been giving,
that's good. Yeah, did you get that? If you don't understand it, you're not going to value it, regard it. Go ahead, Trace.
The seed that you actually know is what prospers.
Yeah, the truths you know. That was one of the scriptures I was going to go to. And then you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. Paula?
I was going to say, the truth will sanctify.
Very good, very good.
Choose not to be offended.
Choose not to be offended.
If we have a problem with people, it's really us that has the problem.
Right on.
You choose your own weeds.
If you have a problem that keeps coming up in your life, it's coming from your heart.
It's coming from your heart.
God moved the boundaries in your heart.
Oh, God. Blessings on you, brother. He said, let God move the boundaries of your heart. I want it to happen. And it did happen that one morning when God just, I just lingered. And then he corrected me. He said, when I decide for your assignment to change, I will let you know. He was strong. But I could feel the boundaries of my heart were moving. Go ahead, Kathy.
All of the limitations of your life are in your heart.
All of the limitations of your life are in your heart. John.
The devil sows the seeds of weeds.
Yeah, the devil sows the seeds of weeds. Exactly.
We need more weed killer.
We need more weed killer.
In order for the seed to grow, you need sun and water.
Yeah. Yeah. Is this good?
Yeah.
Do you understand it?
If there's a big rock in your heart, get help.
Yeah, if there's a big rock in your heart, get help. Amen.
Learn how to garden.
Learn how to garden. Imagine that.
Pastor, when you said that our heart is like a garden, and I usually don't get pictures.
Yeah, right.
But I looked and I seen almost like a like slum landlord who doesn't take care of his property.
Oh, man. That is awesome. I hope you all caught that. That's good. Maddie?
We only have like the money or the relationships or whatever in our life that we are capable of handling.
That's right. Yeah. Because if you know how the Bible says that an inheritance quickly gained at the beginning will not be blessed in the end?
Mm-hmm.
You know, people who win the lotto, they don't bless that after. 10 years later, they wish that it never happened, okay? Because your heart will self-correct you. So if you have $200,000 in the bank and you only have a heart that can handle 100, your heart will make decisions to bring that from 200 down to 100 to the place where you're comfortable. You will. If you have 5 friends and your heart can only handle 3, you will offend 2 of them. And they'll go away. Your heart will make sure of it. Your heart will make sure of it. This is truth. This is truth. But I'm telling you, the power is now in your hands to take the word of God and fix the problems. Go after this with everything you got. Amen? Praise the Lord.